Good morning, New Prospect. It's good to be with you on your screen today. And we just want to say thank you. Thank you for continuing to tune in with us and worship with us during this crazy time. We believe that God is wanting to do something really big with this virtual ministry. And it's our hope that you are taking time to worship and really tune in with us. And we're also praying that God's going to use this time online to help us reach the rest of Anderson for the gospel. If you're somebody who doesn't normally gather with us when we're able to gather, we just want to say welcome to you too. And it is our prayer that whenever we're able to come back together, that you'll join us in our mission to make disciples for the kingdom. As we get started this morning, I got just a couple announcements for you. First of all, our staff and leadership just wanted to remind you that we're working really, really hard on a plan when we can get back together. So we want to make sure you know what that plan is when we can get it to you. And you can do that by making sure that you're getting your booster every week and follow us on Facebook. So make sure you're doing those couple things to stay in the loop. Also, we just want to give a big thank you for your generosity. Your giving has been awesome. And so thank you for continuing to be generous, even when life looks a little different. Also want to remind you about Fridays from 12 to 2. We're going to have a couple staff members here. We're going to have a couple other people here to take up your offering, to pray with you if you want to pray. And also, if you want to give any donations to ministries like Saturday Servants, or if you want to give some gift cards to Seneca, we're taking all that up on Fridays from 12 to 2. So come out and do that. I wanted to encourage you this morning from Matthew chapter 10. And in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus is getting ready to send out his disciples to do ministry. And I particularly enjoy Eugene Peterson's his translation of this in the Message. Listen to this. It says, Jesus sent out his 12 harvest hands with this charge. Don't begin by traveling off to some far-off place to convert unbelievers. And don't try to be dramatic by tackling a public enemy. Instead, go to the lost. Go to the confused people right here in your neighborhood and tell them that the kingdom is here. Bring health to the sick, raise the dead, touch the untouchables, kick out the demons. You have been treated generously, so you should live generously. Don't think that you have to put on a fundraising campaign before you start. You don't need a lot of equipment because you are the equipment. And all you need to keep that going is 3 meals a day. So travel light. I love what Jesus says. He says, you can start right here. You can go to the lost. You can go to the confused. You can go to the hopeless right here in your neighborhood. And you don't need equipment. All you need is you. All you need is the message of the gospel. And you see, our mission hasn't changed. Our mission is to bring people who are near to us but far from God into the kingdom through the message of the gospel. So how can we do this? Sometimes it seems impossible. Well, Jesus answers that very question later on in Matthew chapter 10, where he says this. He says, we are intimately linked in this harvest work. Anyone who accepts what you do accepts me, the one who sent you. Anyone who accepts what I do accepts my Father who sent me. Accepting a messenger of God is as good as being God's messenger. And accepting someone's help is as good as giving someone help. You see, this is a large work I'm calling you into, but don't be overwhelmed by it. It's best to start small. Give a cool cup of water to someone who is thirsty, for instance. The smallest act of giving or receiving makes you a true apprentice. If you start this way, you won't lose out on a thing. You see, Jesus tells us that we can do this work because we're not just doing it for God, but we're doing it with God. When we live in God's kingdom, He is with us. And when we go out on mission, He is with us. And we don't have to start big. We don't have to change the world. But what we can do is change our world by taking the gospel to our neighborhood and showing love to those around us. So New Prospect, let that be your encouragement today. That even though life looks a little bit different, the mission is still the same. And even though ministry might seem a little crazy, your God is still with you to help you carry out the mission. So as we go into worship this morning, let's pray together. Father, we love you. God, we thank you so much for who you are. God, we thank you for what you have done for us. That you are the God who takes your enemies and turns them into your friends. That you are the God who finds orphans and you call them sons and daughters. Father, help us to take that message to our neighbors. Help us to know that we don't have to travel around the globe, But sometimes we can just walk across the street to fulfill your mission. Jesus, help us to know that we don't need fancy equipment because we are the equipment. And God, remind us that you are with us on this mission. Encourage us, Lord, that even if we need to start small, you will be there and you will be faithful. Jesus, we love you so much. We thank you for this time that we can gather together around your word, around you, and worship together. Jesus, thank you. Use this time for your glory. Amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my doom till I met you. I was breathing. Sing this out. This is your story. This is my story.
I'm gonna rescue my sinless head. The chains break out the wind of your glory. I need a shelter. I wasn't born.
Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. And you're out of that.
Amen. New Prospect, we are so glad that today you have gathered with us wherever you are to worship the King of Kings who raised us up out of the grave just like Lazarus. He saved us from our own sin and he gave us new life. So today we just celebrate that. And we want to really soak that up today. And with this next song, this is really our prayer for us as a church. That now that we're alive in Christ, in a time that's tough on us as a church, it's tough on us as people, we want Jesus to use us however he wants to use us. So we're going to yield to him, to his very, very careful hand. We're going to trust him, even though we don't understand, like this song says. So let's just take this song piece by piece, and let's cry out to God with these lyrics, and let's worship together.
You're breaking new ground.
Good morning, you Prospect family. I hope you've had a great week. And just to let you know, we really are getting closer to the time that we can meet together as a church family once again and fellowship together in person once again. You may have heard we're targeting June 7th as our tentative return date. Now, that's assuming that nothing changes with state and local COVID situations, but that's what we're looking for. So check out the booster and check out Facebook and the website for more details and updates. And please, of course, be in prayer for your staff and your deacons as we make preparations for this return. And when we return, know this, by the way, that we're going to endeavor to make this the experience as safe as possible for you. And if you don't feel comfortable in returning, we're going to continue to show our worship services online as well, via Facebook and YouTube and the website as well. But today, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to John chapter 3. We're going to continue our sermon series on Jesus' teachings that we've been in since January. And today we're looking at what is perhaps Jesus' most well-known teaching and speech in all the Gospels, Jesus' famous nighttime conversation with the Jewish leader named Nicodemus, again found in John 3. And we're looking at what Jesus really taught about the new birth. So John chapter 3 will be in verses 1 through 15. Now, if you read the booster this past week, I mentioned that my family and I recently watched the 2019 movie adaptation of what is my favorite Christian classic, John Bunyan's Allegory of the Christian Life, entitled The Pilgrim's Progress. I love this story, and if you've never read it, and I don't often say this about many books, but if you've never read it as a believer, you must read The Pilgrim's Progress at some point in your life. Every believer's life needs a little Bunyan. Few tales match this one. Bunyan actually penned this story in the 1600s, late in the 1600s, while in jail in Bedford, England. He was in jail for illegally preaching the gospel as a nonconformist Baptist minister. The impact of this story is incalculable. Some 200 languages have translated this story. It's been translated in some 200 different languages. It's probably recognized as the most significant work of religious or theological fiction ever written, and it's never been out of print. But as we watched that movie version, though, I was once again struck by the simple power of Bunyan's story, in part because the journey of the main character, Christian, who is representing, of course, Bunyan himself, well, his journey is my journey, and his journey is your journey as well if you're a believer in Christ. Leland Ryklin explained it this way. He said the title by which most people know the book is Pilgrim's Progress. But Bunyan himself called it The Pilgrim's Progress. And that makes a difference, he writes. It changes the focus from a specific person, a character named Christian, to really all believers, all pilgrims, all Christians. In other words, we believers, all believers, join Christian and join Bunyan on this same pilgrimage in Christ. But also, and here's what I want us to realize today, is that all of us who are Christians, like Christian, like Bunyan, and like any true Christ follower, we believers also all have the same beginning point to our journeys. And what is that beginning point? Our beginning point is a radical life transformation that comes from an encounter with the living God and His Christ. Now, Christian, the main character in The Pilgrim's Progress, describes his own radical transformation as one that occurs when he encounters the cross of Christ, and he loses, quote, his burden. Now, his burden represents a weight on his back at the beginning of his journey, which is representing sin and shame and guilt and the curse of sin and the fall, all before salvation, all before encountering Christ. And allow Bunyan to describe this transformation for you. He said, just as Christian came up to the cross, his burden loosed from off his shoulders, fell from off his back, and began to tumble down the hill. And so it continued till it came to the mouth of the sepulcher. This is the open, empty grave of Christ. There it fell in, he said, and I saw it no more. Christian then summarizes, my name is Christian, but my name used to be Graceless. Can you identify with that? Relate to that? Bunyan's is indeed a powerful depiction of salvation, but there's actually many others he could have chosen. In fact, Scripture is chock full of word pictures and phrases to describe the same radical transformation that we as believers experience in salvation. We're saved. We're justified. We're redeemed. We're cleansed. We're atoned for. We're pardoned. We're reconciled. We're adopted. We're sanctified. We've received a new heart. We've become new creations. We were far off but have been brought near. We've received resurrection life, a circumcision of the heart. We were enemies but are now friends of God. We were outcasts but are now brothers and sisters in Christ. We were forsaken but now we're forgiven. But perhaps the most powerful and vivid and well-known of all the biblical images of salvation is that which we find in our text today, being born again. So what does it mean to be born again? And it's a phrase that many of us have heard all our lives, especially if you grew up in a Baptist church. Well, Jesus answers this question of what it means, quite clearly in our text today. In fact, in no other text in the Bible is the subject of regeneration so comprehensively explained. So what does Jesus really teach about the new birth? Well, let's read John 3, but before we do that, let's just set the scene a little. Jesus is still in Jerusalem. It's during the Passover. He's creating quite the stir among the population. He's just cleansed the temple. And for the first time, he's really making a stir among the Jewish leaders as well. He's claiming that if the temple was destroyed, he would raise it again in 3 days. Yet though he was controversial, many were still believing in him, specifically because of the many signs and wonders and miracles he had performed. One man who had had his curiosity piqued by Jesus was, quote, a Jewish ruler named Nicodemus. Nicodemus is only mentioned here in John's Gospel, here in John 3, and then later on in chapter 19. For John, Nicodemus seemingly becomes representative of all seekers of Christ. Nicodemus is identified, as I mentioned, as a ruler of the Jews. This means that he is probably a member of the Sanhedrin, a group of 70 religious leaders, both Pharisees and Sadducees, who represented the highest Roman-sanctioned governing body in Judea during Jesus' day. They were kind of like the Supreme Court in Congress put together, with power only superseded, of course, by the Romans themselves. Nicodemus is also identified as a Pharisee, a group notoriously hostile to the message of Jesus, but a group that Jesus often targets with some of his harshest criticism as well. But here, Nicodemus demonstrates that at least some of that group perhaps were open to his teaching. Nicodemus's reputation and his status as a prominent Pharisee are perhaps some of the reasons why he approaches Jesus at night, though I think there's actually another reason that I'll get to in just a minute why John mentions this. So Nicodemus approaches Jesus clandestinely, silently, in the night. And let's read from John 3 to see what happens next. Verse 1. Now there was a man among the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you have come from God as a teacher, for no one can do these signs unless God is with him. Jesus answered and said to him, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven. Nicodemus said to him, How can a man be born again when he is old? He cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born, can he? Jesus answered, Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be amazed, Jesus said, that I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but do not know where it comes from and where it is going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? And Jesus answered and said, Are you not a teacher of Israel? Do you not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak to you what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not accept our testimony? If I told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven but he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so also the Son of Man must be lifted up. And so that whoever believes in him will, in him, have eternal life. Let's pray as we begin. Father, we thank you for this text. Help us, Father, to see the teaching of this text, the beauty of the new birth. Help us to understand. And Father, I pray if there are those who are listening to this who have not experienced this new birth for themselves, I pray that today might be that day. In Christ's name, amen. So if I was to ask you, what does it mean to be born again? What would you say? Would you say that you are a born-again believer? What would that mean to you? And what kind of impressions does being born again have in our world today? Seemingly, that phrase is as confusing today as it was to people back then, including to Nicodemus. For instance, some people today see the phrase born again as almost synonymous with the label evangelical or fundamentalist. Some people today see the phrase as applying to those of a certain political persuasion. Oh, I know that you voted that way because you're one of those, quote, born-again Christians. Some people today see the phrase as applying to only fervent believers. Oh, I'm a Christian too, but you must be one of those born-again types. Some people think that born-again refers to becoming perfect or something that happens at baptism or something that happens when you get to heaven, and the list goes on. One thing I think that we can establish before we look at Jesus' teaching on the new birth is this, that being born again is actually synonymous with being a Christian. Indeed, the phrases born-again believer and born-again Christian are really just redundancies. You know what a redundancy is, right? It's saying the same thing twice. Phrases like 12 o'clock noon or close proximity or each and every or pair of twins or sudden explosion. Former Vice President Dan Quayle famously stated, "If we do not succeed, we run the risk of failure," saying the same thing twice. In the same way, born-again Christian is really saying the same thing twice. It's a redundancy. If you are a believer, you are a Christian, and you are in fact someone who has been born again. In other words, there is no one who is a believer in Christ, a Christian, who is not also born again. There is no such thing as a non-born-again Christian. Here's the fact I bet some of you didn't know. I didn't know this, that all thoroughbred horses in the Northern Hemisphere actually have the same birthday. No matter what day of the year they were actually born, they're all considered to have been born on January 1st. As Christians, we don't share the same actual birthday, but we all share the same birth, or should I say, the same new birth, the same beginning point to our journeys in Christ. So what does it mean then to experience this new birth? What does it mean to be born again? What does Jesus teach about this idea to Nicodemus? The first is this. Regeneration, or the new birth, is a radical transformation that brings us into the people of God. In our text, one of the first things to notice is that Nicodemus comes to Jesus at night. Now, obviously, as I mentioned earlier, this could be just in order to avoid detection as a prominent member of the Pharisees or a ruler. But I think that in the context of John, there's actually some subtle symbolism going on here. You see, in John's gospel, John often represents and contrasts light with darkness. Light representing truth embodied by Jesus himself, darkness representing this realm of Satan, error, evil, unbelief. And in here, in other words, Nicodemus seems to be coming to the light out of his own darkness. It's a picture of a man in error and in unbelief. But he was about to have the light shine into his own unbelieving heart. Nicodemus addresses Jesus as rabbi, as one come from God. This Jewish leader probably thought that he was being respectful, since most of his class would have considered Jesus a commoner, a part of the Am Haaretz, the people of the land. And Jesus was a young commoner at that, and one who lacked no formal rabbinic training. Did Nicodemus think he was being respectful? Would Jesus have been appreciative of this stamp of approval? Whatever Nicodemus expected, what Jesus then told him in verse 3 rocked his proverbial Pharisaical world. You see, as a Pharisee, Nicodemus did not consider his status as a, quote, child of God, as a child of Abraham, a child of the promise, to be even in question. He'd been born of the seed of Abraham. He was an inheritor of all the covenant promises by birth. He had been circumcised on the eighth day, which made him a member of the covenant community by birth. He was an inheritor of the kingdom of God by birth. Like other Pharisees, he believed he would be resurrected one day because of his birth. And as he remained a member of the covenant community because of him being a child of Abraham, he had followed the Torah since his birth. Now, of course, Gentiles were a different story. When a Gentile became a Jew in the first century, they would shed their old identity via two things, via circumcision and through what they would call a mikvah, a ritual bath, in order to become a child of Abraham. But in no way did Nicodemus need this, right? He was already part of the children of Abraham by birth. He was already heir of the promises by birth. And herein lay Nicodemus's shock at Jesus' response to him. Jesus said that Nicodemus was not entitled to an inheritance in the kingdom of heaven based on a physical birth as a descendant of Abraham. Entrance into the kingdom is solely based on what Jesus would call a spiritual birth. Indeed, Nicodemus was just like the Gentiles in that way. He was just like the Am Haaretz. Nicodemus needed a radical transformation. He needed to be born again. Listen to John 1, how he describes it. John 1, verse 11, Jesus, came to his own, that's the Jews, and those who were his own, the Jews, did not receive him. But as many who have received him, that's anyone, Jew, Gentile, you and me, to them he gave the right to become what? Children of God, even to those who believe in his name. And notice this, who were born, not of blood, not of the will of the flesh, not of the will of man. In other words, not of physical descent, but born of God. In other words, to be part of God's kingdom, you had to be radically transformed. It was like you had to be reborn, but reborn into a new line, born from above. Nicodemus famously misunderstands this concept in verse 4 as a physical rebirth, but Jesus points out that this rebirth is spiritual, and it's not optional, Jesus says. Jesus tells this good Jew, this physical child of Abraham, you must be born again into this new family in order to enter into the kingdom of God. The old lines of physical descent are not enough. You must undergo a spiritual transformation to become part of God's new covenant people. Now, we'll get to how that's accomplished in a minute, but let's dwell on this fact for a moment. If you're a believer this morning, listening to this, this has happened to you. You were not a child of Abraham, most of us, if you're not Jewish. You're not a child of Abraham by physical descent. Instead, as the Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians 2, you were a child of wrath. But now you're born again into God's new covenant people. You're not a child of wrath, you're a child of the King. So what actually happens to us when we're born again? Now hear me out. Most times when we think of being born again, we think of becoming a new creation. Your being has changed. You are a new you. And I think that's right. We have become new in some way. For instance, a story is told of St. Augustine that soon after his conversion, he was walking down the street and passed by a prostitute that he had known during his debaucherous days. She called out to him, but he didn't answer. He just kept right on walking. Augustine, she called, it is I. Without missing a beat, Augustine replied, yes, but it is no longer I. Because of Christ and this rebirth, Augustine was a changed man. He was born again. He was a brand new creation. And that's the way I've always understood it. Born again does mean that we're new creations. But I think there's something much deeper and more profound and more exciting going on here. Born again is more than just a transformation of our being. Jesus isn't just saying your heart is changed. He's stating that your status has changed. In other words, you have not just been reborn and transformed, you have been reborn into something. And this is an exciting truth. You know, when a child is born, it's a miracle, no doubt, but when a child is born, he or she is born into a family. Your destiny and status is tied to that family. And so also, when we are born again, yes, we're transformed, but you are also transformed and brought into the family of God, into his promises, into his covenant people. Lee Eklov tells a powerful story that illustrates the nature of this new birth in Christ. John Foote, a relative of his, and his wife Lori had worked for a while with some teenage groups in Nebraska. And during that time, they met a young girl named Amanda, a teenage girl who was the same age as their son, Wesley. Amanda came from a terribly abusive home and was eventually taken from her parents by the state. But John and Lori took her in as foster parents. And after a while, after conferring with their two sons, John and Lori agreed to legally adopt Amanda. She took on their last name. She was now Amanda Foote. She even got a new birth certificate. John and Lori now have three legal heirs. Amanda has two new brothers. She has no longer any claim upon her former parents who disowned her, nor they upon her. John and Lori Foote had thought of Amanda as their daughter for a long time as foster parents. But Eklov asked them if anything felt different after that day at the courthouse when Amanda was legally adopted. And this is what John said. Absolutely, he said, when it was official there was a huge change in Lori and me. Sort of like, listen to this, sort of like when you see your newborn for the first time. And for Amanda, there was a change in her too, he said. Now she knew she belonged. She knew we were her parents. Amanda was not merely transformed, but she was transformed and brought into something. This is like our new birth through God's beloved Son, Jesus. In the new birth, God has given us a new name, His. He's given us a new legal standing. We are justified and co-heirs with Christ. He has given us a new family. We are brothers and sisters in Christ, and God is our true Father. Friends, you are Amanda Foote. You have been born again, radically transformed, yes, but more than that, you've been radically transformed and adopted into something, into the kingdom of God, into the family of God, into the new covenant community. Let me give you three quick applications based on this radical transformation. First, if you've been born again into God's family, live like it. Henry Erdman tells it this way. He said, if I had a car with an engine that was ready for the grave, I'd have to have a new engine put into it. I'd take the car into a mechanic who would put it in for me. However, he states, if I got that car back and it ran just as poorly, I'd begin to wonder if the old engine had really been replaced or if it was simply just cleaned up. He says it's not any different with our new lives in Christ. If we have been changed, it should be obvious to all. A true work of grace in the heart is evident to the person himself as well as to the people around him. Tim Keller calls this radical transformation a, quote, life quake. I love that word picture. He states, when a great big truck goes over a tiny little bridge, sometimes it's called a bridge quake. When a big man goes onto thin ice, there's an ice quake. However, whenever Jesus comes down into a person's life, there's a life quake. Everything is reordered. Anything, any view, any conviction, any idea, any behavior, any relationship, Jesus' new birth changes everything because we're born again into a new family, into God's kingdom. Second, another application is this. If you've been born again into God's family, celebrate it. We tend to downplay the glory of our own salvation sometimes. You've heard me say this before, but many of us are tempted to say, I don't have much of a testimony. I just grew up in church, or I simply was baptized as a child. No flashing lights. No sudden visions, no drastic changes, none of these experiences like the Apostle Paul on the Damascus Road. No, friends, you have a radical transformation that is to be celebrated. From separation from God to becoming part of the family of God, from a child of wrath to a child of the King. You have been reborn from above into a different destiny. Celebrate that today. Praise God for that today and tell others about that today. Third, a final application just based on this first point is that if you've been born again into God's family, be part of it. How sad would it be for a child to be born into isolation? No family, no one to care for them, no one to show love to them. You've not been saved to be in isolation. You've been saved and reborn into a family. You've been saved into a people of God. And so be part of it. Contribute to it. Live in fellowship with that family. So first, Jesus teaches that regeneration or the new birth is a radical transformation that brings us into the people of God. But secondly, Jesus teaches that regeneration or new birth is a radical transformation that brings us into the people of God and is brought about by God alone through His Spirit. So how does this new birth happen? Do we birth ourselves? I think this is part of Nicodemus's question. Does a baby birth itself? Can we just declare ourselves to be part of the family of God? Can we declare ourselves to be children of Abraham? Let Jesus describe it for you in this text. He says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Not of flesh," verse 11 of chapter 1, "not of flesh, not of the will of man," John states, "but of the will of God." But what does Jesus mean here when he says that you must be born of water and spirit? Now here's my Old Testament colors coming out here. This is drawing on Ezekiel 36, a passage where Ezekiel is prophesying of God's renewal of his covenant people in the new covenant. You could say that Israel, his covenant people, are being born again in the new covenant. And there, Ezekiel writes, Ezekiel 36, starting in verse 25. Let me read this to you. He says, "Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and all your idols." There's the water. "Moreover, I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit within you." There's the spirit. "I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you, and I will cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will be careful to obey my ordinances." Now, listen what Jesus is doing here. By drawing on these images, he's reinforcing the point that we just made, that what God is doing through Jesus is he's doing that transformation now. He is forming a new covenant people through Jesus. He is rebirthing Jesus' followers into this new covenant. But notice what I notice about this passage, even more than that, is God's initiative to create this new people through the new birth. If you look back at that text, notice what it says. Notice the eyes. "I will sprinkle, I will cleanse, I will give, I will put, I will remove, I will give, I will put, I will cause." This is God's initiative. Do you see it? I mean, you don't give yourself a heart transplant, do you? No, you allow the surgeon. The work of the new birth, of cleansing by water, the gifting of the Spirit, is also completely the work of our great surgeon, God Himself, through His Spirit. Here R.C. Sproul explained, "Rebirth or regeneration is done by God and God alone. A dead man can't cooperate with his resurrection. Lazarus did not cooperate in his resurrection. Regeneration is a sovereign act of God. After God brings us to life, of course, we certainly are involved in cooperating with Him. We are to believe, trust, obey, work for Him. But unless God acts first, we will never be reborn in the first place." One author describes it this way. Told a story recently of his friend Linda, who had a cat to escape. It was cold and rainy, and the cat wouldn't come home, not for 3 days. That cat wasn't exactly lost. Linda knew exactly where it was, a good 20 feet up a tree right outside the back of the house. But that little critter just wouldn't come down. So another friend named Jim took a long extension ladder over to help, and that cat probably hadn't eaten in 3 days. It was cold and scared, but when Jim finally got there, the cat was not, it wasn't glad to see him. It was downright hostile. In fact, the only way Jim got the cat down was to put a towel over its head and pry its claws out of the tree. Jim did all the rescuing. The cat couldn't rescue himself. Salvation is a lot like that. None of us can look to Jesus, remembering our rescue, remembering our salvation, and say, "We made a good team, didn't we?" No, all the glory for salvation goes to God now and forever. Now, because God alone gave us this new birth, what does that mean for us? To me, it means this, that no one is beyond hope. God has the power to save any, no matter how high the tree of sin that we as rebellious cats have climbed. Speaking of the power of Christ to redeem any and all sinners and build His church, Russell Moore recently wrote this. He said, "The next Billy Graham might be drunk right now. The next Jonathan Edwards might be the man driving in front of you with a Darwin Fish bumper sticker decal. The next Charles Wesley might be currently a misogynistic, profanity-spewing hip-hop artist. The next Charles Spurgeon might be managing an abortion clinic today. The next Mother Teresa might be a heroin-addicted porn star this week. The next Augustine of Hippo might be a sexually promiscuous cult member right now, just like, come to think of it, the first Augustine of Hippo was. But the Spirit of God can turn that around, he writes. He seems to delight to do so. And notice what he writes here. The new birth doesn't just transform lives, creating repentance and faith. It also provides new leadership to the church. It fulfills God's promise to gift his church with everything needed for her onward march through space and time. So then, regarding the new birth, we see that Jesus teaches that regeneration or the new birth is a radical transformation that brings us into the people of God, but is brought about by God alone through his Spirit. But let me add one more thing that Jesus teaches here about the new birth. It's a radical transformation. It brings us into the people of God. It's brought about by God through his Spirit, but it's for all who would believe in his Son. So how do we respond to this new birth offered by God? Several times in the book of Acts, this same question appears. What shall we do, brothers? Asked the people at Pentecost in Acts 2, after Peter preaches. Sirs, what must I do to be saved? Asked the Philippian jailer in Acts 16. So what do we do? Reform yourself? Try to do good things? Go and do the expected religious activities? Attend church, fast, tithe? In verse 15, Jesus offers a simple and beautiful response to God to receive his offer of salvation and a new birth. The response? Simple and beautiful belief. In the early 1700s, a 21-year-old Oxford student realized that his debauched, wicked life needed to be reformed. He resolved to change. He denied himself every luxury. He wore ragged clothes. He ate no foods except those that were repugnant to him. He fasted twice a week. He gave his money to the poor. He spent whole nights in prayer, lying prostrate on the cold stones. But he felt like he was just putting a coat of paint on rotten wood. His outward deeds only hid his inward corruption. But then a college friend, a fellow I mentioned last week, Charles Wesley, gave him, this struggling young man, a copy. By the way, that young man's name was George Whitfield. He gave him a copy of a book by a Puritan named Henry Scougal, which was entitled The Life of God in the Soul of Man. Whitfield read Scougal's book with amazement and delight. It told him that true Christianity is the union of the soul with God. It is Christ formed in us through faith and through the new birth. Whitfield wrote about this. He said, "When I read this," and I would add, "when I believed this, a ray of divine light instantaneously darted in upon my soul. And from that moment on, but not until then, did I know that I must become a new creature. And having undergone innumerable buffetings by day and night, God was pleased at length to remove my heavy load and to enable me by living faith." And I would say, by simple and beautiful belief, to lay hold of his dear Son. "And oh," he exclaimed, "with what joy unspeakable and full of glory was I filled with when the weight of sin left me." Sounds like Bunyan, doesn't it? "And an abiding sense of the pardoning love of God broke in upon my disconsolate soul." Whitfield's favorite scripture became John 3:3. "Verily, verily, I say to you, except man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." He went on to preach 18,000 sermons, sometimes to outdoor crowds of over 20,000 people, by the way, with no microphone. He made many trips to America and was used greatly in the First Great Awakening. In one of his final sermons, he said, "I am now 55 years of age, and I tell you that I'm more than ever convinced that the truth of the new birth is a revelation from God himself, and that without it, you can never be saved." A friend asked him one day, "Why do you so often preach? You must be born again." "Because," Whitfield said, "because you must be born again." So what should our response be to Christ's offer of new birth? Simple, beautiful belief. If you're listening to this today, and if you have not experienced this new birth of which Jesus speaks, simply repent and believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. So Jesus teaches that regeneration, or the new birth, is a radical transformation that brings us into the people of God. It's brought about by God alone through his Spirit, and it's for all who would believe in his Son. So, what do you believe about the new birth? Is it just a title for you? a political persuasion, a description of those on fire Christians? Or is that redundant title, being born again as a Christian, something that you are? If not, today could be your salvation. God can bring this radical transformation to you just as he did to a man named Minkaye, a hero of mine, one who passed away just a few weeks ago. Now, you've heard me tell part of Minkaye's story before because it intersects with one of my other Christian heroes, Jim Elliot. In the mid-1950s, Elliot and four other missionaries, including a missionary pilot named Nate Saint, left for Ecuador. And they were going to evangelize the Huarani, an ancient tribe that had never been reached with the gospel. The missionaries made contact with the tribe, and they were using an airplane with a loudspeaker and a basket to pass down gifts. Now, after several months, the missionaries decided to build a base just a short different distance from the village. They had been encouraged by one or two friendly encounters, and they began to make plans to visit the Huarani. But then in January of 1956, they landed the plane on a small beach in the river near the village. At first, the Huarani seemed friendly, but raising their spears, they attacked, and all the missionaries were slaughtered. The men had all agreed that even though they had guns, they wouldn't use them, even if attacked. They had told each other that they were ready for eternity. The Huarani warriors were not. One of those warriors was a tribesman named Minkaye. His spear was actually the one that killed the missionary pilot, Nate Saint. It's a tragic massacre. But the blood spilled by those martyrs provided the seed of the gospel to go forth. Several of the missionary wives continued to attempt to reach the tribe even after their husband's death. And not long after that, Minkaye, one of these Huarani men who speared to death Nate Saint, he became a Christian. He was born again. This was a radical transformation and a new birth brought about by God himself. It brought him into the people of God, and it was because Minkaye believed in God's Son, Jesus the Christ. You know, many years later, Minkaye became an elder in that village church. He later said of his transformation, "We acted badly, badly, until they brought us God's carvings." That was his phrase for the Bible. And then he said, "Then seeing these his carvings and following his good trail, we now live happily and in peace." You know, there's something about new births. As mentioned, Minkaye was not just born again. He was reborn into a family, the family of God. And this was literally the case for Minkaye being born into another family as well, in addition to his being born again into the family of God. For Minkaye, years later, he met the young son of Nate Saint, whom he had murdered. Steve Saint and his family had come to live among the Huarani. Because he had killed Steve's father, Minkaye felt a special responsibility in helping to raise him. A kinship bond was formed between Minkaye and Steve, and Minkaye adopted Steve as his tribal son. In 1995, when Steve was older, he brought his own family to live permanently with the tribe, and Minkaye considered Steve's children as his grandchildren. It's an amazing story of God's healing, grace, and mercy, of God's new birth. This man, Minkaye, was now part of a family, the family of the man he murdered, part of the family of God. On April 28th, just a few weeks ago, this great warrior turned soldier in Christ and truth away, went home to be with the Lord. Grandpa Minkaye, as he was called by those who knew him, journeyed through what Elizabeth Elliot, the widow of Jim Elliot, famously termed in her book about the missionaries, the gates of splendor. Steve Saint wrote of Minkaye's passing, "He was one of my dearest friends, one of my dearest friends in the world. Yes, he killed my father, but he loved me, my family, and he loved Jesus." Friends, if you're in Christ today, and I am fully convinced of this, one day, if you're in Christ, you will have the chance to meet Minkaye. Why? It's for one reason. You too have been born again into a kingdom of God, into God's family, just like Minkaye. You too have been radically transformed through a new birth, brought into a new family, brought about by God alone through his Spirit. And it is because you, like Minkaye, like Bunyan, like millions of others, believed in God's Son, Jesus, the Christ. If you're not a believer, you too can be born again into a new family through God alone, by His Spirit. Simply, beautifully, believe in the gospel and start your journey, your pilgrimage, your pilgrim's progress with Christ today. And one day, you'll be with Christ in that celestial city. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the hope of Jesus, the promise of Jesus, the transforming power of the gospel. Father, as we've looked at this very crucial doctrine of being born again, this crucial teaching of Jesus, Father, I pray for those of us who have experienced this transformation, I pray that we would once again celebrate it. We would live like it. And Father, we would realize that we have been born again not just to live in isolation, but born again to be part of a larger family, yours, the family of God, your new covenant community, the church. Help us to love it, to serve it, even as we serve you. And Father, help us through our service to the church to let others know about this beautiful transformation that's available to all who would believe of the new birth. Father, I pray if there are those here who are listening to this who have not experienced this new birth, Father, I pray that today might be that day of salvation for them. Father, I pray that through this word from you, this word from your scriptures, this word that Jesus himself proclaimed, that it would, through your Spirit, transform lives. As Ezekiel says, I pray that there would be hearts of stone transformed into hearts of flesh. I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so kind and true. I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. Is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father? There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou and love, grace.
to you at the close of this service with no power, no strength, no salvation in our own. We found our salvation in the blood of Jesus. Lord, we thank you that Jesus paid it all. Lord, we thank you that we can be born into a new kingdom, into a new life, into a new future. Not because of what we did or have done, but because of what Christ has done. Lord, we pray for those who have not said yes to you. Even at this moment, Lord, encourage them to bow their heads and say yes to Jesus. Lord, for those of us who are so blessed to be in the kingdom of God, help us to never forget it is our mission to spread that good news so that everyone can hear and believe. We commit to you this service. We pray that you will take our lives as we go out into this world that's troubled by so many, many problems in the days and weeks to come. Lord, we pray that we'll be a beacon of light pointing those in need to a Savior. In Jesus' name we pray together. And all God's people said, amen and amen.